whatever you do, don't fall asleep.
I'm scared to close my eyes. I'm scared to open them. I'm gonna die out of here.
I'm eternal child. I am the eater of wounds and of children.
Oh my god, it's the 1980s, with the Literary License Podcast retrospective of 80s horror films, with your co-hosts, Joe Radazzo, Vicky Ray, John Wilson, and Keith Shago, keeping everything tubular and rad.
You're not even gonna swat that fly. I hope they are watching. They'll see. They'll see, and they'll know, and they'll say. He wouldn't even come
alive. I'm your number one fan.
Well, hello, everyone, and welcome to a special edition of Literary License Podcast. And if I'm sounding a little strange, because it's not Keith Chago hosting today, it's Joe Randazzo. I'm here with Vicky Ray.
Hi, everybody.
And we're joined by our special guest, writer, director, producer. He's worn many hats. He's worked with some of the greats and has had a long and illustrious career, Mr. Sam Irvin.
Great. I'm so happy to be here, Joe and Vicky. Thanks for having me.
It's really nice to meet you.
Well, thank you for coming on. Well, I guess how I found out about you. I mean, I've seen the Oblivion movies because I was a kid running around the video store, and I watched the two Oblivion movies and Magic Island, because I used to rent Full Moon stuff all the time. And about a year ago or so, I commented on something that either Tim Lucas or David Del Valle or one of those horror historians had posted, and you commented on it. You responded to one of my comments, and I was like, Sam Irvin, that name sounds familiar. I looked you up, and it's Elvira's Haunted Hills. Yep. Oblivion, Out There, all these movies that I just absolutely loved. And I thought, I need to friend this guy. I need to see if I could pick his brain a little bit, because I grew up loving some of your movies. And what I discovered about you is that you're also very cool to your fans. You're constantly engaged with them online. You're constantly doing giveaways. And
I think that's fantastic.
Yeah. You are. As far as, you know, working directors, filmmakers with their fans, you are so really cool to everybody. And I just want to publicly thank you for that, because you can totally ignore people. And you don't seem to do that. You seem to be totally down to earth, very, very cool with people.
And it's so important to do, because fans appreciate it so much.
Absolutely. Well, I appreciate all of the love that I get from all of the fans and followers and stuff. And I had on Facebook a couple years ago, somebody, I mean, I'm pretty tongue in cheek on my Facebook page all the time. And somebody said, you know, you should have a name for your followers. You know, Lady Gaga has little monsters, and the Grateful Dead have the Deadheads, and Barry Manilow has the Fanilows, and you need a name for yours. And I said, well, you know, my favorite name of all is Benedict Cumberbatch's followers are Cumberbitches. And so then I decided I'm going to hold a little contest on Facebook. And I asked people to submit ideas. And somebody recommended Samwitches.
That's what that was all about.
Cumberbitches. And I thought Samwitches was hilariously perfect. And we spell witches because I'm a horror kid, a monster kid, as W-I-T-C-H-E-S. So it's sandwiches. And so I'm in love with my sandwiches, as we call them. And it's, I love going to conventions and engaging with everybody. I mean, I'm a monster kid like all the rest of us, and started out, you know, as the kid with Famous Monsters of Filmland and every Aurora model kid, and, you know, all the tropes. I was there, and I did my own horror fanzine as a kid called Bizarre. So, you know, I'm just a kid in a candy store with all this stuff, and can't believe that I've been lucky enough to direct some of these movies that are such labors of love. And so, yeah, I mean, you know, I'm a horror geek and totally own it.
Wonderful. I grew up with that stuff kind of a couple decades later. I grew up with a lot of it on the, when a lot of the Aurora monster kits and stuff were being reissued in the 90s, that's when I was buying them. And I was buying old issues of Famous
Monsters. You're not as ancient as I am.
Well, you don't look. He's a baby right now because he's not as ancient as I am either.
I just turned 40. You tell my knees they're not ancient.
You're still a kid.
Yeah, well, I turned 65 this year. And I joked that that's 18 Celsius.
That is a good way of looking at it.
I feel 18 for sure.
You're 18.
But I was growing up, you know, I grew up in the 60s. So I was there for all the, you know, Famous Monsters first. I mean, I've subscribed and the Aurora kits and all that stuff was coming out right when I was a kid. I mean, it was fantastic decade to grow up in, and all the, you know, shock theater on TV showing all the old Universal films. And that's how I discovered all those. My dad was owned a movie theater. So I was really spoiled in that sense, in that I could get in free to all the movies. And he would let me, even from the age of like 12 or 13, I was booking kiddie matinees on Saturday morning. And it was always horror movies. And it was all the Vincent Price, Edgar Allan Poe movies, which I later spoofed in Elvira's Haunted Hills. It was all the Hammer films. It
was, that was major, you know, spoofage of Hammer. You could know as soon as I was watching that, it's like, oh, wow, this is all hammered out.
I mean, Elvira's Haunted Hills, for sure, is the most fun I've ever had making a movie. It just was, and I got, you know, it was really a spoof of those Vincent Price, you know, like Pit in the Pendulum, House of Usher, Tomb of Ligeia, Haunted Palace, all of those, especially in addition to Hammer and everything else. And even The Fearless Vampire Killers is in there with Elvira in the bubble bath, like Sharon Tate was and stuff.
Yeah.
But both Cassandra Peterson, who's Elvira, and I both were major Vincent Price fans as kids. Her very first horror film that changed her life was The House on Haunted Hill. And the first horror film that changed my life was The Pit and the Pendulum. And we later, you know, got to know Vincent Price. She got to know him and would appear on talk shows with him. And he came on her show, Movie Macabre, in the 80s and stuff. And I met him. Well, I started writing to him. I met him in London and met him several more times. Then I developed a film project that I was going to direct that was scripted by Brian Clemens of the Avengers TV series fame and Captain Cronus Vampire Hunter and Dr. Jekyll and Sister Hyde, fantastic writer. And it was going to star Vincent and his wife, Coral Brown. And of course, you know, we could never get the financing together, and it never happened, to my dismay. But you know, I got to know he and Coral through that whole process, and it was just a really meaningful part of my life to be able to have gotten to know him for sure. And so when we did Elvira's Haunted Hills, we dedicated the film to Vincent Price. The Richard O'Brien plays Lord Helzebus at the castle, and that character is very much modeled after all the Vincent Price characters in those movies. And Richard, who wrote, he was Riff Raff in Rocky Horror, but he also wrote Rocky Horror. He wrote the music, the lyrics, the play, the screenplay when they did the movie, everything.
Fantastic. Yeah.
And he's a huge Vincent Price fan as well. So he knew exactly what we were spoofing, and we just had the best time making that movie. It was so much fun. And we got to build the sets from the ground up and design them as an homage to the Poe films. And it was just an amazing thing. And we're celebrating, actually, right now, the 20th anniversary of that movie and Shout Factory just last month in October of 2021 came out with the Blu-ray of the film, 4K restoration. It looks absolutely incredible. Awesome. And we have a ton of extras. And we filmed a brand new introduction of Elvira with her red couch and everything, introducing the movie, which we shot just a couple months ago. And anyway, it's just a really exciting celebration of the movie. And it didn't get distributed very well originally. So I'm really hoping that it's going to, you know, reach beyond the cult following that it already has. And it seems to be. And of course, Cassandra, as you probably know, just also released her memoir the same month. And it went to number 4 on the New York Times bestseller list. And there's an entire chapter on the making of Elvira's Haunted Hills. And so I'm really excited that the synergy of the book coming out and everything, and a lot of people will be reading about this movie and maybe you've never heard of it and I'll check it out. And so I'm really, really excited.
I have seen a lot of chatter on social media about it as of late. So that is a good sign. But yes. You know what? The funniest part about that whole movie was probably just one of the smallest things, but it was the dashing, handsome Fabio kind of guy you had in the Haunted Hills and how he was speaking. You know, you're like dubbing his language. That was just killing me because my husband walked in when I was rewatching it and he's going, he kept looking at it. I go, no, I go, he's just that. It's just, you know,
that's one of the greatest TV. Voice actors working. That's Rob Paulson, I believe.
Did the voice. Well, what happened was, just really quickly, we wanted Fabio to play that role.
Did you really?
Yes.
That would have been awesome too.
He turned it down, which turned out to be a blessing in disguise because we decided we were already a little, you know, our budget was getting really, really tight and we were, you know, we shot it in Romania and actually some of the locations were in Transylvania.
Oh, cool.
And the, and before I forget, let me just do a quick little sideline. Cassandra and I are hosting two tour groups of 40 people each in this coming May. To go to Romania and visit all the locations where we shot Elvira's Haunted Hills. I mean, it's insane. Each tour group is 9 days. We're going to do them back to back. So we're going to be there 18 days showing everybody where we shot the movie. Okay. And it's going to be incredible. Anyway, check that out. I think there's some seats left on the second tour. The first one is sold out. But at any rate, I'm really excited about that coming up.
Have a credit card. Joe, you got a credit card?
Exactly.
When
Fabio turned the roll down of the stable stud, we decided that, you know, we're already bringing in a number of the other actors. It's getting really expensive. Let's just cast the guy in Romania.
Right.
So we get over there and we're auditioning guys and they're just not handsome enough or the ones that are handsome can't act and or they don't know how to speak English. It just nothing was quite right. I also wanted a guy with long hair because we didn't have the budget to get a really good wig and I hate guys in wigs that always looks really wiggy and fake. And so I just told the casting director, just bring in guys with long hair. Well, then this guy walks in the door, Gabriel Andronaki, and Cassandra and I look at each other like, whoa. And he is the hottest thing. And he's exactly what the role needed. And but then he opens his mouth to read the scene and he can't speak English worth a damn. And we tried to get him to speak the lines phonetically. And there was just no way. You couldn't understand anything he was saying. And then I just got this inspiration and I turned to Cassandra and I said, listen, we have to have this guy. Let's let him do it in Romanian and then let's dub it badly, like those Steve Reeves Italian Hercules movies.
Oh my God, Steve Reeves movies. Yes.
And she cracked up and we were like, do you think it could work? And I'm like, I really think it could work. And We were worried, however, because he has several scenes in the movie, and we thought, is this going to be a one-joke thing where, you know, it's funny the first time, but then it becomes a groaner and when we keep repeating it.
Oh, but it was great.
When we would show the film at midnight shows, because it didn't really get much, it didn't get any theatrical runs, but we took it to festivals and we did midnight shows here in LA, and Cassandra and I would go and do Q&As and stuff. And we loved sitting through the film because different audiences would laugh at different things. And it was just really fun to get that feedback and to know what was funny to people. But those scenes with the stable stud got the biggest laughs, and they got laughs every time all the way throughout. So people weren't tired of it. In fact, as soon as people saw him, they would start laughing even before he opened his mouth, because they were anticipating that it was going to be badly dubbed. And, it was just, it couldn't have been more perfect. And Joe, you are right. The guy that dubbed the voices, Rob Paulson, my God. I mean, he is a brilliant voiceover actor who's done a trillion cartoon voices and is just one of the top guys in the business. And luckily, he was a friend of Cassandra Peterson, and she asked him for a favor to come in and do this. And he just killed it. He made it so, so funny. And then we had him do a couple other voices in the film. I don't know if you know. There's a little homage to The Shining, where at the very beginning, Elvira and her French maid are in this little hotel tavern thing in Transylvania. And the guy, the landlord, comes through the door with an axe like Jack Nicholson. And he says, "Here's Johan." And that's Rob Paulson. He dubbed that guy's voice.
Yeah, at the end, the Terry Thomas.
Yes, exactly. At the very end of the film, there's a gentleman who picks them up, who picks Elvira and her maid up in a coach, just the very last scene. And Jerry was the choreographer, and he wrote the song of Le Musical, the musical number that happens in the middle of the film. And he was Cassandra Peterson's choreographer back in this 1970s, long before Elvira had even been thought of, when she was a performer in Vegas. I mean, they go so way back. It was so much fun to have him there because they're such good friends. And we were, you know, looking for people who could speak English and actors. And this, we had this one little tiny role, and I said, let's get Jerry to do it. And we go to Jerry, and he's like, "Oh God, but I'm not an actor. I just don't know." And he said, "Well, you look perfect for the part." So then we did the scene, and he was right. He wasn't an actor. And he is the first to admit it. He warned us. And so I said, you know, it'll be fine. It'll be fine. Don't worry, and we ended up asking Rob Paulson to do a voiceover as Terry Thomas for him, and that's what happened, and it worked out perfect. It was, again, it was just the perfect thing, but I'm still really glad we got Jerry in there.
Such a and for those of us who out there who don't know who Terry Thomas is, he was a great British actor. He's in a lot of Amicus movies, and actually next year, I think we're all covering our franchises, and I chose the Amicus portmanteau movie. So
yes, he's in some of those. He's also in both of the Dr. Fives movies, playing completely different characters. And he's the British comic actor. He has the big gap between his two front teeth. That's kind of his trademark. Yeah. And really, really funny actor. But you recognize his voice the second it starts to come out of Jerry's mouth.
He's the one. I haven't seen Dr. Fives in a little while. I think he's the one that gets killed watching the stag film, right?
Yes, that's exactly right. In the first one. And in the second one, what is he in the second? I think he's, oh gosh, I'm blanking out. But he's in both. He's definitely in both.
Well, backtracking a little to the stable stud, I was watching the... I was watching the Blu-ray of Haunted Hills with the audio commentary on, and there was mention of apparently him having a jealous girlfriend who was on set at all times.
Yes. Yes, so Gabriel had that? A jealous girlfriend. She was, you know, Elvira, come on. She was very worried about the love scene that we were going to do in the stable. Of course, you know, it's a PG-13 movie. There was going to be no nudity or anything. And, you know, it's just, they kind of start kissing and then sink down out of frame and, you know, that's it. But yeah, she was very nervous. And so she would be right there the whole time.
Wow. How funny.
It was cute.
And backtracking a little to Richard O'Brien, I wasn't aware that he was a big Vincent Price fan. Yes. On the outdoor scenes when he's out in the cemetery, he looks exactly like Vincent Price did in the Tomb of Ligeia. Yes. So is that more yours or Cassandra's idea? Was that just him paying tribute to his favorite Vincent Price character?
It was all of us. But we knew, Cassandra and I knew long before we even cast Richard that especially that scene was going to be an homage to the Tomb of Ligeia. And we, before we even left for Romania, we searched high and low everywhere for those horse blinder wraparound glasses that Vincent Price wore in Tomb of Ligeia.
So oh, I love Richard could have
those. We had everybody looking all over town and antique shops and everything, and literally found two pairs. We found one that was in really good condition and then one that was kind of crappy, because at one point she slaps him and they fall to the ground. So we used the crappy ones for the stunt moment. And yeah, I was like, I'm not getting on the plane if we don't have those glasses, because I was like determined I had to have an homage to Tomb of Ligeia. And if you recall, the Vincent Price characters in each of those movies has different sensitivities. Like House of Usher, he can't, you know, his taste, he has to have very pallid, you know, food, and his taste buds are oversensitive. His hearing, he can, I guess it's in Pitting the Pendulum, his hearing is acute and he can hear the scratching of the people who are alive in their coffins down in the sarcophagus.
Oh, and that's right.
He can hear the rats in the walls and all of that. And then in Tomb of Ligeia, he has very sensitive eyesight and can't be out in the sun and whatnot. So we combined, or I should say Cassandra and the screenwriter, John Paragon, combined all of those sensitivities into one character for our movie. And so he's just sensitive to everything. And when I was reading the script, I was just cackling because I totally got where every single one of those things came from. And so anyway, we just were all on the same page and just a blast. I mean, the way that I got the gig to direct this is that I had known Cassandra for several years. I met her at a party right after I did my first feature film, Guilty as Charged. I met her at Terry Sweeney's house. He was a regular on Saturday Night Live. He was the first openly gay Saturday Night Live cast member, and he used to do Nancy Reagan and drag. This was back in the mid-80s or whatever.
Yep, I remember.
And I knew he and his husband, Lanier. Lanier and I went to school together at University of South Carolina. It's all really weird how this all happened. But I'm at their house for this party, and I spot Cassandra, and I run over to Terry, and I say, oh my God, it's Cassandra Peterson. I'm such a huge fan. I've got to meet her. Please introduce me. And he introduces me and says that I recently directed a film called Guilty as Charged. And it was a dark comedic thriller, a horror movie about a madman played by Rod Steiger who kidnaps murderers and fries them on his own electric chair. And so anyway, Cassandra goes, oh my God, I just saw that movie. I loved it. In fact, I've been wanting to meet you, because if I ever do another Elvira film, I want to consider you as a possible director for it. And I'm like, whoa,
wow,
this
yeah.
is fantastic. So we got to know each other. I had her do a cameo in my second film, Acting on Impulse. She didn't play the Elvira character. I had her as a bouncer at a country western bar where she wore a blonde wig and did kind of a Dolly Parton kind of thing. And she cards Nancy Allen, Linda Fiorentino, and C. Thomas Howell as they enter the bar. and she had a great time, and we just remained social friends and throughout the 90s. And at the end of that decade, around 1999-ish, she called me up and she said, listen, we have tried to get another Elvira film going everywhere in town and nobody wants to do it. So my husband and I have decided we're going to finance it ourselves. We're going to mortgage our house and we're going to just do it. And I always promised you that I would consider you as a director, and we're interviewing a number of other candidates, but I want you to come up to the house and meet with us. So I went up to their house, a house which, by the way, they later sold to Brad Pitt.
Nice.
So she hands me the script and she goes, this is Elvira's Haunted Hills. It's a spoof of the Vincent Price Poe movies. Are you familiar with those? And I'm like, honey, I know those films backwards and forwards. This is Vincent Price's monologue from the climax of Pit and the Pendulum. Do you know where you are, Bartolomeo? You are about to enter hell, the Neverworld, the infernal region, the abode of the damned, a place of torment, Gehenna under rock of the pit, and the pendulum, the razor edge of destiny, thus the condition of man bound on an island from which he can never or hope to escape, surrounded by the waiting pit of hell, which must destroy him finally. And she looked at me like I was absolutely insane and said, you're hired. And that's how I got the gig. And I had learned that monologue in junior high school. The teacher did an assignment for, it was kind of a drama thing where they wanted us to recite monologues. And they're thinking like, you know, the teacher was thinking, you know, Shakespeare kind of stuff, whatever, very academic. And I'm like, look, I'm allergic to iambic pentameter. And I just had no interest in that. And I said, can I do Edgar Allan Poe? And the teacher said, okay. And so I raced home knowing full well that The Pit and the Pendulum had very little to do with Poe. It was all written by Richard Matheson. But I went home and back in those days, this is like the late 60s, I taped on reel-to-reel audio tapes off of television, like holding the microphone up to the speaker. I taped movies and I had Pit and the Pendulum on audio tape, and I transcribed that whole monologue and learned it and got an A. The teacher never even, you know, questioned whether this was actually Poe or not, thank God. and then a couple of years later, I met Vincent Price for the very first time. I went to see him play Fagin in a touring company of Oliver. I grew up in North Carolina in Asheville, and this was being performed in Atlanta, Georgia, which was a 4-hour drive. And I badgered my mother to drive me down there to see it. We did. And we went and stood at the stage door afterwards, and Vincent comes out and there's a lot of fans and everybody. And when it's finally our turn, I tell him that, you know, oh, I'm such a huge fan. And my dad has movie theaters and we show all your movies, and I show your older movies on kiddie matinees, you know, did the whole thing. I even brought a flyer that had like a Vincent Price sort of retrospective that I was doing every Saturday for matinees. And then I said, and I happen to know your monologue from Pit and the Pendulum. And he said, you do not. And I said, yes, I do. And I recited it to him right there. And all the other people who were waiting in line behind me ended up applauding. It was like this moment. And so I definitely made an impression on Vincent Price that day. But that monologue, you know, to imagine that like 40 years later, it, you know, would come in handy to get me the job to do this love letter to Vincent Price is just, it's incredible to me. It makes the hair on the back of my neck stand up. And I obviously still know it to this day. I'll never forget it.
That's wonderful. And actually, the first thing that I saw that had, apparently when I was a kid in the 80s, I'm in the video store all the time. And according to all my relatives, I used to rent one movie all the time. I used to rent it all. I'm a kid and I can't get through it.
But I used to rent the Monster Club with Vincent Price and John Carradine.
Yes.
Donald Pleasence and Britt Eklund and Stuart Whitman, the cast. But it was hosted by Elvira. So, right. And it was just something about that front cover with Elvira, with the very colorful movie poster. So, in a way, Vincent Price was kind of, and Elvira kind of helped me discover that before I even knew what horror films were, that that's what I was kind of drawn to. Because I'm like 8 years old. Maybe 6, 7 years old, going, no, that's the movie I want. And I was like, you just rented that last week and you never watched it. I'll start it, I'll never finish it. But so you mentioned Nancy Allen, who is another person who is iconic. You know, she's in so many great movies in the 80s. You worked with her originally on Dress to Kill, I believe. Is that the first movie you worked?
The first movie I worked with her on was Home Movies. When I was just finishing school at the University of South Carolina. I was a huge Brian De Palma fanatic. So when I was in college, I happened to be running the movie theater on campus, and we had a whole film series that was going, you know, that we would book and program ourselves. I had a little film committee. And we decided, let's do a Brian De Palma Film Festival. So I looked up in Hollywood Reporter in the production charts that Carrie was in pre-production and they were casting, and there was a number for a casting office in California. And I called that number and they put Brian De Palma on the line. That would never happen today.
No, I don't think so.
No. And I explained what we were doing. And he said, hey, I'm kind of broke. I live in New York. I really need to get to my apartment to get some things. If you'll give me the airfare from Los Angeles to Columbia, South Carolina, where I was going to school at the University of South Carolina, then to New York, so I'd be there for the weekend, and then back to LA, I'll come for the Triangle airfare. And I said, done. And we had a budget with our committee and with the money that we made off of ticket sales and our little theater and stuff. And that's how we paid for it. He came out. He had just recorded the score for Obsession with Bernard Herrmann. And he had a cassette tape that he played for us of cues from Obsession. And this was in November of 75, and the movie didn't come out until August of 76. So this was many, many, many months before anybody had heard those cues, of that magnificent score. And he was talking about how he wanted Bernard Herrmann to do the score for Carrie that was coming up, and didn't know that the very next month, in December, right after recording his final score to Taxi Driver for Scorsese, that Bernard Herrmann unfortunately passed away just a few hours after the last recording session of that movie. So it was really kind of weird that, you know, we were listening to Bernard Herrmann's cues from Obsession before he had passed away. And whereas everybody else, you know, heard it many months later after he had gone. But I took Brian to film classes and to do Q&As at some of his films that we were showing. And the climax of the whole thing was going to be this midnight show of Phantom of the Paradise, which I loved. And we had everybody come in costume. It was sold out, 300 seats. Brian, you know, judged the best costume. We had prizes. The whole place was pumped. We start the movie. Well, we did the Q&A ahead of time only because it was going to be so late when it was over. So we did the Q&A. Then we start the movie and there's no sound. I panic. I run up to the projection booth. What? Do you turn on the sound? Da, da, da. It turns out that the sound bulb was burned out. And they, you know, projectionist should have had spares, but didn't. And it's too late to go buy one, and you know, you can't exactly buy those at 7-Eleven. And so we had to cancel the screening and send everyone home. And I just thought all the goodwill that I've built up by meeting Brian De Palma just got flushed down the toilet. However, I was wrong. And this will show you what kind of sardonic sense of humor he has. He thought it was hilarious. And later, later working for him as his assistant. I worked on The Fury, And then home movies with Kirk Douglas and Nancy Allen, and then Dressed to Kill. And he loved to tell that story when he would introduce me to people and to embarrass me, but, you know, with tongue in cheek and good humor. And, but it, you know, it made me memorable, I guess. And he loved that story. And so it just really worked out incredibly well. And when I did The Fury, I wasn't working for him full time at that point. I was still going to school. It was between my junior and senior year during the summer. And I went up to Chicago where they were shooting, and I worked as his assistant and worked as an extra in the amusement park scene. But I also got an assignment from Cine Fantastique magazine to do a journal on the making of the film. Now, I would have done the journal for my own fanzine, Bizarre, but I had kind of ended it because I was getting so busy doing these other things with De Palma and, you know, really pursuing my career. But I had gotten to know Fred Clark, who was the editor of Cine Fantastique, because of my own fanzine. And Fred was very sweet. He even bought a double page ad in my magazine just to kind of, you know, help support the cause. And so I knew him. And so I called him up and said, "Hey, listen, I'm going to be working on this film. I know you did this incredible cover story on Carrie, which De Palma really liked. And, you know, can we do a cover story on The Fury? And I'll do this whole making up thing." And he said, "Great, done." So it was like a whole slam dunk. Well, it allowed me to have one-on-one interviews with Kirk Douglas and John Cassavetes and all the important people on the film. And I went up during my Christmas break where they were editing in New York and got to meet Paul Hirsch, who was the editor, who, of course, you know, did Star Wars and just legendary editor. And I even got on the phone with John Williams, who did the score for that movie. I mean, it was just incredible. And without that assignment, you know, to be a journalist, a legitimate journalist, you know, they're not going to, nobody's going to pay attention to a little lowly, you know, assistant. So that worked out incredibly well. Unfortunately, when Fred, the magazine issue kept getting postponed, he ended up, because Star Wars came out and Fred Clark went crazy about Star Wars and did this huge double issue. And he did run my interview with Amy Irving as kind of a appetizer for The Fury in that issue, and said, you know, there'll be, you know, a big thing on The Fury coming up. But then the movie came out and he saw it, and Fred Clark hated it. And so he canceled the having it as the cover. He still ran the article, but he cut it down a bit. And then, you know, I had to go in with my tail between my legs to De Palma and say, "Well, they've canceled the cover. It's just going to be an interior article." And he didn't care. It would meant, you know, he didn't mind. Whereas for me, it was like I felt the whole world was collapsing. But at any rate, I was actually on the first time I met Nancy Allen on Home Movies. It was a low budget film, and Brian had me be the associate producer and production manager and just kind of threw me into the deep end to see if I could swim. And then, and I guess I did okay. Cause then at that point, then he hired me full time as his assistant, and I worked in development and on a whole bunch of projects that didn't get off the ground or he didn't end up directing. But, during that time he made Dressed to Kill, which I worked on. And then I worked for about a year on the development of Blowout. And right about the time that Blowout was going to shoot, Brian wanted me to produce a low-budget coming-of-age movie called The First Time that another protege of his was going to be directing. And so I went off and we shot that right at the same time they were doing Blowout. And it had Wallace Shawn, Wendy Jo Sperber, Catherine Damon, Tim Choate. It was a really cute coming of age thing that New Line Cinema released. And unfortunately it was kind of a lost film, but we got Bill Finley, who was the Phantom of the Paradise and the doctor, Mad Doctor and Sisters. he rewrote the script with his wife. And so there's a lot of De Palma connections, and De Palma has a credit on it as creative consultant. He was going to be executive producer, but Bob Shea, who's the head of New Line Cinema, wanted that credit, and Brian was not going to share the credit with him. So yeah, Brian just said, nope, just credit me as creative consultant. So anyway, that's what happened, why I didn't actually work on the shoot of Blowout. And after that, I did a short film that I wrote and directed and produced called Double Negative. And
I was going to ask you about that. That was a little known one, but yeah, I heard it was actually very good. I went looking for it. I haven't found it yet.
Well, it is part of the extras of the Fury Blu-ray, but it's the European edition. So it's the one that Arrow put out in England. It's also on the French one.
Is that your 20-minute short that was in Sundance? Yes. Okay.
Yep. And it was a 20-minute short called Double Negative. It was about a horror film director making a low-budget horror film called Coat Hanger Massacre. Oh. And it is sleazy producers, Max and Milt, named after Max J. Rosenberg and Milton Sabotsky of Amicus, are played by Bill Finley, who is the Phantom of the Paradise, and Wayne Knight, who was Newman on Seinfeld. And and they decide that they'll make more money if they steal the negative from the lab and collect the insurance than to actually finish the film and release it. And the director, played by Bill Randolph, who played the cab driver in Dressed to Kill, and he was also in Friday the 13th Part 2, he gets wind of this little plot, and he and his leading lady have to steal the negative first in order to save their film, put dummy negative in theirs, and then they actually filmed the producers stealing the film so they could blackmail them and into finishing the movie. Anyway, it's cute. And there's a little flashback of the director as this sort of prodigy kid. And we've got Justin Henry from Kramer versus Kramer to play the young director character. Oh, I
totally forgot about that one.
And so, yeah, it was really fun. And it got accepted at Sundance, got a lot of buzz. It opened. I did it in 35mm because I wanted it to play in theaters. And it did. It opened in Los Angeles with Martin Scorsese's After Hours. And in New York, it played with Emerald Forest, the John Borman film. It got reviewed in the New York Times by Janet Maslin, got a really nice review. So that became my calling card, which enabled me to get my first feature film off the ground, which was Guilty as Charged. So the long-winded build-up
Rod Steiger wasn't guilty as charged, wasn't he?
Guilty as Charged. Rod Steiger, Lauren Hutton, Heather Graham, Isaac Hayes, Zelda Rubinstein of Poltergeist fame. We had an incredible cast. And it's very German expressionistic. The dungeon sets where he has this electric chair where he fries murderers who've gotten off. And so it's got lots of horror elements. And one of the reviews compared it, said it's a cross between James Wales, Bride of Frankenstein, and Robert Fuse, Dr. Fives movies. Well, there couldn't be a bigger compliment in the world for me. Absolutely. I mean, I just about fell out of my chair when I read that.
that could bring us to probably another big film that you're known for, the Academy Award winning for screenplay. And I think you were nominated as a producer for Gods and Monsters.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I was one of the producers of Gods and Monsters. It did not get a Best Picture nomination, unfortunately. It certainly should have. It got three Oscar nominations for Best Actor for Ian McKellen, Best Supporting Actress for Lynn Redgrave, and then Best Screenplay, which it did win. For Bill Condon, who did the adaptation from the book by Chris Bram, but Bill also directed the film. It did win some other Best Picture awards in some of the critics associations, like the National Board of Review. My God, we swept the whole damn thing. It was won Best Picture, Best Actor, Best Supporting Actress, Best Director, and Best Screenplay. It was just incredible. Lynn Redgrave won the Golden Globe for Best Supporting Actress. And there were lots of other, you know, awards that were showered on our little movie, which we're all so proud of. Bride of Frankenstein is my favorite film of all time. And James Whale is certainly one of my all-time favorite directors. I'm openly gay, and James Whale was gay. I've always identified with him and his work, and especially with Bride of Frankenstein. So for those who don't know, Gods and Monsters it's about James Whale in the later part of his life, and Ian McKellen plays James Whale. But there's a flashback scene of James Whale directing Bride of Frankenstein on the laboratory set, which we had to recreate. And I made sure that it was recreated perfectly. And we tracked down some of the original electrical equipment that was designed and created by Kenneth Strickfaden for the original Frankenstein, Bride of Frankenstein. And Mel Brooks had tracked it down for Young Frankenstein. So it has this incredible legacy of appearing in films. It even appeared in a few Skid Row movies like Dracula versus Frankenstein and a few others. But we found it, and it's in there. And man, that was a moment when we were shooting those scenes. I just, it was a dream come true. Just couldn't believe it. And what a film. I mean, it's just an absolute masterpiece. And, I can't believe it's already like 22 or 3 years old now. I mean, it just feels like it was yesterday. I also co-directed The Making Of, that's on the DVD. And I guess it's on the Blu-ray as well. That I co-directed with David Scall, who's a well-known horror historian and has written many great books. And we shot footage during the making of the film. We interviewed all the actors, but we also interviewed Gloria Stewart, who was still around at that time. Oh, wow. And she had starred in James Whale's The Old Dark House and James Whale's Invisible Man. And she is known by everybody as the old woman in Titanic. But she knew James Whale really well. And so we interviewed her on camera. And we also interviewed Curtis Harrington, the director of Games and Who Slew Auntie Rue and a bunch of great films. But he was very good friends with Whale back in the late 40s, early 50s. And you know, they were really, really close friends. Curtis was also gay, and you know, Curtis was always very, very much a gentleman about it. But I'm pretty certain that they were romantically involved for a bit. But also Clive Barker was one of the producers on Gods and Monsters, and so we interviewed him. And so it just was a great conglomeration of people that I admire. And of course, Bill Condon's career just exploded after that. And he's just been unstoppable.
There's some artwork that's in that movie. Like in particular, there was one sketch in James Whale's bedroom that caught my eye. And I'm wondering if a lot of that stuff was created for this, or if it was just stuff that, like, you being a horror fan, and I'm sure Clive Barker and all these other guys who are just huge monster kids, did you guys just use like stuff that you guys had, or was it all just created for the film?
Most of that artwork was actually James Whale's original artwork. Wow. We tracked down people who owned actual original pieces. And when we couldn't find certain pieces, we would recreate as best we could, or, you know, whatever, the production designer would do something. But most of that was his actual artwork. When Whale retired from directing, he took up painting, and that's what this film is really sort of centered on, those years as him as a painter. We also, just a quick story, I mean, his, we wanted to shoot in the actual home where James Whale lived. And I don't, you know, it's a bit of a spoiler, but it's been enough years have passed, I guess. But, you know, people know generally that James Whale took his own life and his in the swimming pool behind his house, very tragically. But we did find the house. The house had actually belonged to Goldie Hawn and Kurt Russell for a while, but not at the time we were going to be we wanted to shoot there. But we went and talked to the owners, and they were not interested in having a film crew in their place. But they said that they would allow us to come and tour it so that we could see what it was like, so we could look for a place that would be very similar and have the same feel. But also, we just wanted to kind of soak it up, soak up the atmosphere of the actual place. And we arranged to have a tour, and Bill Condon and myself and the production designer and the director of photography and a couple of other people, plus Ian McKellen, who had just arrived from London. And so we all arrive in the driveway, except for Ian, who's coming from the airport or wherever. And he's a little late, and we're waiting. We don't want to go knock on the door until we're all together and ready to go. And suddenly this like 1940s Jaguar Roadster comes roaring up the driveway and convertible. And Ian screeches to a halt. He hops out of the car, doesn't even open the door, just leaps out. And he is dressed in these hip hugger bell bottom slacks that are patent leather and baby blue.
Oh my God.
And look like they have been bought on Carnaby Street in 1969. And he was like, "Oh, hello, everyone. Sorry, I'm late." You know, and it was just, we were all dying laughing. It was the funniest image. And, you know, and I'm expecting, you know, back then, you know, now we're used to Ian McKellen on talk shows and we know that he's funny and, you know, all kinds of stuff. But we didn't know. We're just thinking this is some, you know, Shakespearean actor who's coming over from England who's going to be very sedate, and you know, and he just completely wiped that image right off the map. And that's how he was the whole movie. He was just a kick. He was so funny and sweet and hilarious, and we just all adored him.
Was McKellen a big big old school monster movie fan as well?
A bit. I mean, I can't say that he, you know, he had to do his research a bit, but he certainly knew of the films and had seen, you know, seen the Whale films and that sort of stuff. But I don't think of him as a you know, monster kid in the sense that we are.
Yeah. So also on the Frankenstein note, because you had produced a film that, Ryan Reynolds is in, and recently, when he was doing Deadpool 2, there was this funny little video with him and David Beckham, where David Beckham says something about movies he should apologize for, and he mentions Bolt Neck. And Ryan Reynolds, as Deadpool, screeches and goes, "Bolt Neck was a masterpiece."
That is news to me. I'm not even aware of the video.
I'll send you the video. It's only like a minute long.
Oh my God, that's hilarious! Well, it's a kind of a very obscure lost film, but yes, it was called Bolt Neck. It also went under a bunch of different other titles: Teen Frankenstein, Monster. Teen Monster, Big Monster on Campus, all these different names. But anyway, yes, it was this cool little. It was kind of it was a bit of a ripoff of Frank and Weenie, to be honest.
Frank
it was
about and Weenie.
A teenage boy who, you know, is creating a Frankenstein monster in his attic in Spielberg-esque suburbia. And instead of, you know, bringing a dog back to life, he brings a kid back to life, and the kid is Ryan Reynolds. And so Ryan Reynolds sort of plays the Frankenstein monster.
He's funny.
The, the family name of the kid and his parents is the Steins, and
Matthew Lawrence.
Thank you. Oh God, thank you.
Yeah, I just watched
who I adore, and I directed Matthew Lawrence in My Santa. So I'm like, oh my God, if I can't remember his name, he's going to kill me.
It's on one of the Roku channels. I just watched it on Saturday. I'll look it up and I'll get back to where it's on so people can check it out because I really enjoyed it. But yeah, go ahead.
And the parents are played by Shelley Duvall and Judge Reinhold. I mean, it's an incredible cast on this little tiny low budget film. And so yeah, it's fun. And there's one part that I always remember that just cracked me up. There's some teenagers like at a lookout, you know, in their pickup trucks and stuff, making out and drinking at night or whatever. And the camera is just sort of, you know, on a track rolling by, you know, two or three of these pickup trucks where kids are in the back. And this girl and guy, just extras, are kissing. And the guy stops for a second and leans over the edge of the pickup truck and throws up from, you know, having too much to drink. And then he sits back up and goes right back to kissing the girl. And as the camera's just going by, you know, it doesn't halt or anything. It's just this little, you know, just little passerby, you know, drive-by moment that just, it cracks me up every time.
What's really cool to me about that movie is that you have Ryan Reynolds, who's one of the most charismatic leading men in movies now, 20 years later, kind of playing against type, because he starts out as kind of like this kind of nebbishy loser heavy metal kid.
Yeah.
And he just, it's just really cool to see him playing that. And then he accidentally gets killed when he goes to a party he's not invited to. And the guy's knock him into the empty swimming pool. But it is a very cool little movie. I'm glad I checked it out. I'm glad I went through your IMDb and I started looking everywhere, like what can I find, especially the stuff I hadn't seen. I revisited the Oblivion movies, which is the next ones that I want to talk to you about, because God, what an amazing
excellent.
How did that come about? Because it looks like the story was by Charles Band. Was it all his idea, or did you have a lot of input in the creation of Oblivion?
No, well, I had done Guilty as Charged and Acting on Impulse with Nancy Allen. And then I had a manager in those days. Her name is Venetia Stevenson, and she was also an actress. She was in Horror Hotel with Christopher Lee, she was married to Don Everly of the Everly Brothers. And,
oh, no kidding.
You know, she had quite a Hollywood history. Her mother was Anna Lee, who was in The Sound of Music and Whatever Happened to Baby Jane. Her father was Robert Stevenson, who directed Mary Poppins. Anyway, she knew Charlie Band, and she said, I want to introduce you to him. And so we went in for a meeting. And Charlie had, by that time, he had seen both of my first two films, Guilty as Charged and Acting on Impulse, and which he liked. And they had a film of Oblivion in development and quite far along. The script was done. They had character designs. They'd had some artists do little renderings of each of the characters and what the costumes could possibly look like, that sort of thing. And so he gave me the script. Charlie gave me the script and said, "Hey, you know, what you can take this and read it and see what you think. And I'd love for you to consider directing it." And so that, I mean, it just came about really quickly, slam dunk. Now, once we got into pre-production, we were, you know, designing the Western town and everything, and it was starting to get pretty expensive. At that time, Charlie had a deal with Paramount, so we actually had some real money for a change. And I mean, it wasn't real money in terms of Hollywood, but in terms of low budget films, you know, we had a budget, and we were going to shoot it in Romania, and labor is cheap over there. You could build sets. It was the first time I'd gone to Romania. I later went for the Elvira movie. And so, you know, we knew we could build this town, but, you know, we still had a budget and we had to be careful not to be too elaborate. Well, the first designs that we have were a bit too elaborate. And Charlie was saying, you know, oh, you're going to have to lose some buildings and whatnot. And then I said, listen, remember the Three and Four Musketeers that Richard Lester did? And they ended up dividing it into two movies. And I said, what if we write another script and do a sequel? Because this is just begging for a sequel anyway. And let's shoot them back to back. And that way we can amortize the cost of the town set over two films. And Charlie loved that idea. And I think he had maybe done it with, I can't remember if Transfers had shot two films back to back at that point. It may have already been done, but that's what we did. And it enabled us to build the town exactly as we wanted it. And it was fantastic. And then I was very much behind the idea of casting a lot of cool,
Julie Newmar,
you know, genre names so or whatever, like George her. Takei from Star Trek to play the town drunk, and Julie Newmar to play the Miss Kitty, the feline alien who ran the saloon, as obviously as an homage to her Catwoman days, and Carl Steichen, who was Lurch in the Addams Family movies and the giant on Twin Peaks, would play the Gaunt, the Undertaker. And we had Meg Foster as the cyborg deputy, and Irwin Keyes, and you know, just this incredible cast.
Yeah, Andrew Divoff is another one.
Yes. Oh my God. And Andrew played Red Eye in Oblivion. He played his twin brother
yeah.
in Oblivion 2. And then played Blackbeard in Magic Island. I mean, I just love the guy.
You know it's him with all that makeup on. I guess it was the one eye.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. You don't recognize him in the Oblivion films. However, in Oblivion 2, I gave him a cameo as another actor, as another character in the Draconium where people come to cash in their draconium that they mine. And Isaac Hayes is the guy behind the counter weighing it and giving, you know, exchanging it for money.
Well placed too. He's funny.
And Andrew Divoff plays this really, you know, crazy character who comes up to the window but at any rate, it actually gets his face in there for a few minutes.
I mean, that cast is what, you know, a teenage kid walking around the video store looking at boxes. That cast is what drew me to rent them in the first place because, you know, you grow up a Star Trek fan and a Batman fan and all this stuff. And you start seeing, oh my God, this
you
is
know
so cool.
Who those people are.
Well, exactly. And that's cool. What, you know, again, that's my fanboy coming out. You know, I wanted my films, especially back in those days when I had much more control over casting than I do these days in the types of films that I direct for the Hallmark Channel or Lifetime, where it's cast, they're cast corporately. You know, I have almost no say anymore. But back in those days, I just relished in getting all the people that I wanted to see on the screen. And it was so much fun to cast those films and bring in people that I wanted to meet, you know, and idolize. And it was just great.
That is, yeah. That and also I didn't know until I rewatched them last week, because back when I had first seen them and even the first couple times I'd seen them, you have a cameo very early in each of them. You die right at the beginning of the second one. you try to rob Isaac Hayes.
What happens in the second one, my favorite of the two, of course, is the second one. It's a little funnier. In the first one, I'm just in one of those stocks where I'm obviously, you know, have done broken the law or something. And when Red Eye comes into town, he breaks the lock on the stocks because he would like, you know, there to be outlaws raising hell everywhere, and I run away and that's it. In number two, I sort of think it's the same character. We called myself Stogie Joe in part two, and I arrive at the tavern where Isaac Hayes is the bartender, and I come in and I pull out a cigar, and my sidekick strikes up a match or whatever to light the cigar, and Isaac Hayes points to a sign that says no smoking, and I'm like yeah, as if, and I just keep taking drags on the cigar, and then boom, I get shot in the back, and we cut to Lash, played by Musetta Vander, sitting at a table in the corner blowing the smoke off the end of the barrel of a pistol, and she goes, those things will kill ya. And then we cut back to Isaac Hayes, and he's got a piece of chalk now, and he's adding a swash to a whole row of where it's obvious that they've killed off like a whole bunch of other people who smoked in the bar.
That's so, what it was. It was an attempted robbery for some reason. I watched so many movies in like the last week that like I'm starting to get things confused.
Yeah.
And actually, you have a similar joke in the first Oblivion where when Red Eye crushes like a little animal, then adjusts the population sign.
Yeah.
It's the opposite end. He goes and crosses it out and
that's what I knew. I was going to finish the movie. When I saw that scene where he eats to whatever that is, I just assume he ate him, but I knew it's just like, I'm going to keep watching this. This works.
I love them because they have such a great sense of humor, and some of the set design at times, like you can kind of see how your love of old monster movies kind of figures in. I got some Cabinet of Dr. Caligari vibes at some points with the town, and I don't know if that was intentional or not.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, for sure. And even like the Undertaker's place is shaped like a coffin, all kinds of wacky, tongue-in-cheek silliness. And no, we had so much fun with that. And I got to do stop motion animation.
Oh, I know. I forgot about that.
I mean, my whole homage to Ray Harryhausen. I mean, with the giant scorpions and in Magic Island, the kids film I did for Charlie after those, I did a stone giant sequence. I mean, it's just incredible. Love doing all that.
Zachary Ty Bryan from Home Improvement.
Yes.
And French Stewart was in
French
that.
Stewart.
That was a really fun little movie.
And another third one, I Rock from the Sun.
You can almost tell you guys had fun making it, but how well the chemistry came through with everybody on the set.
Yeah, we had a blast on Oblivion and Magic Island. With Magic Island, we shot in Mexico in Ixtapa, Zihuatanejo, and it was just as much fun and just had an amazing, amazing time. I love doing those adventures, and it was such adventures going off to these exotic places to make them.
And then in the second one, you brought in another actor who you ended up working with quite a few times, Maxwell Caulfield.
Yes, Maxwell. Oh, my God. I love him so much. And his wife, Juliette Mills,
who
just yesterday turned 80.
I saw the picture you posted. They look fantastic.
They look incredible. And, oh, my God, they're just such a dream couple. I love them so much. And have directed Juliette in a couple things. And Maxwell in several things. I did Oblivion 2. He was also in episodes of Strip Mall, the Julie Brown series on Comedy Central that I directed. And then he was in one of my Christmas films called I'm Not Ready for Christmas for the Hallmark Channel. I love the guy. I'd work with him more if I could.
My sister-in-law, who is not into horror movies, but she loves watching a lot of those. That's one of her favorite Christmas movies.
Oh, that's Hallmark. Great.
Everybody loves those. Hallmark, especially around Christmas and the holidays, I thought.
I've done about 9 of these now. I mean, it's like a whole subgenre of my resume. It's crazy.
I've noticed that a lot of the horror directors from like the 80s and 90s that I grew up liking are now doing those, because you're doing them. David Dakota's doing them. Fred Olen Ray is doing them.
Yeah.
I think Michael Verratti is now writing some of them. I mean, he's not from back then. He's more contemporary. But
Yeah. And Ron Oliver. Yeah. A bunch of us guys are in that world now. It's you know, it's where the bread and butter is. You gotta work.
Yeah.
And then I also do a ton of thrillers for Lifetime. And these, most of the guys you're mentioning also do, you know, a bunch of those too. Well, that's a little bit more, you know, closer to the horror world.
Right.
And we can, you know, do all the noir atmosphere and suspenseful stuff, which is always loads of fun.
Well, I just watched The Nurse last week, because that's on YouTube, on one of the YouTube channels that has licensed that. So I just watched that last week when I was starting to research your films a little more. And that was again a fun little thriller. And you got the cliffside, you know, the cliffside murder that opens the movie up.
Yes.
So kind of showing your affinity for those older movies. I mean, it's kind of
the music too. I found this incredible composer, Nick Sewell, who, when I was teaching at the University of Southern California's School of Cinematic Arts, he was going to the film composing department for his master's degree, and he had scored several short films. And I kept, when we'd have these little festivals on campus of watching, you know, presenting students short films, and there were so many times when I go, God, the music in this is great. And then the end credit would come up and it was always Nick Sewell. And I'm like, I've got to meet this guy. And he was just brilliant. And so I used him for that film and a bunch of my other films too. But that one we had so much fun with. The producers kind of gave us free rein, and I temp scored it with, you know, Bernard Herrmann and John Williams and, you know, all the sort of classic, classical sort of styled scores. And Nick just recreated it and just did this incredible score for it. Let's take a quick break because I hear some delivery at the door and my recording. Are we good?
There we go. It's back cool. On. So we just stopped talking about The Nurse. So amazing thing about talking to you is that you're going into stuff that I was going to ask you about.
I know. He's answered pretty every question I was going to ask. So, I mean, it's just like we're just sitting here just listening, which is great. You know, it's great. You know what? You've got it all down. But I did want to ask you about one story, and it is kind of going back because I saw you on another interview and it cracked me up so much. I believe you were on the set of Man with a Golden Gun, maybe. Was that it? And then you were in the, you were in the car with.
Yeah. Don't give it away. All right. Okay, so this is what happened.
All right. It was a really cool story. So.
When I was a teenager doing editing and publishing my fanzine Bizarre, I had, you know, wanted to meet all my horror idols, and I'd managed to meet Vincent Price, as I told you earlier, but I wanted to meet Christopher Lee and Peter Cushing and all the Hammer people. And so I had conducted through the mail questionnaire interviews with Christopher Lee, Peter Cushing, Ingrid Pitt, and a bunch of them. But I really wanted to meet him in person. So when I graduated high school, I begged my parents as a high school graduation present to send me to London. And so they agreed. And so I wrote ahead to Christopher Lee and Peter Cushing and everybody and saying, I'm coming. I want to, you know, I'd love to meet you and do a follow-up interview in person. And Christopher Lee wrote back, gave me his phone number and said, call me when you get to London.
Outstanding.
So I get there, I call him, and he said, I called him on the weekend. He said, I'm working, so why don't you come to Pinewood Studios and we'll have lunch. And I didn't, you know, there's no internet. I didn't know what he was doing. And, you know, I didn't want to keep him on the phone too long. You know, I was nervous and everything. So I had no idea what he was up to. I just went to Pinewood to meet him for lunch. Well, it turns out he was shooting Man with the Golden Gun, the James Bond movie in which he plays the man with the golden gun. He was the villain, Scaramanga. And so he had been broken for lunch early. So the dining room was pretty empty and fabulous, beautiful dining room. And we had lunch and I taped a new interview with him. And then people start filtering in for their lunch break, including all of the James Bond people, Roger Moore, Britt Eklund, Maude Adams, the director, Guy Hamilton, Hervé Villechaize, who was playing Christopher Lee's sidekick. They're coming by the table where we are, and Christopher is introducing me, and I'm just like, my eyes are popping right out of my head. I just can't even believe all of this. And so then Christopher says, well, you know, they're going to be having, you know, busy with lunch for an hour. Why don't I give you a tour of the James Bond sets? So I get a private tour of all the Bond sets from Christopher Lee. Oh, cool. And he ends the tour at his lair, at Scaramanga's lair, where they're going to be shooting after lunch the rest of the afternoon. And we're walking through, and there's this little insignificant alcove that you barely see in the film. I think people just walk through it and you see it for a flash. But it's lined with these glass cases of hermetically sealed collection of giant insects and giant butterflies and everything that the character Scaramanga collects. And I'm looking at these and I'm going, are these real? And Christopher stops and he goes, Sam, this is a James Bond film, not a Hammer film. It literally, his nostrils flared when he said Hammer film, like there was shit on the bottom of his shoe or something. Oh
my goodness.
And you know, I love Christopher Lee to death, but you know, he kind of looked down on his earlier horror days. And he really wanted to work with the big boys on big major films. And to his credit, that's exactly what he accomplished. I mean, he went on to, you know, work with Spielberg in 1941, with Scorsese and Hugo, with Peter Jackson and all the Lord of the Rings and Hobbit movies and Lucas and in the Star Wars films. And, you know, just... you know, he worked, and Tim Burton, my God, you know, and everything. But the irony, of course, is that all of those great directors loved Christopher Lee and cast him in their movies because of his horror films, because of his Hammer Dracula days. And so anyway, it was just kind of funny that, but that was how Lee was. I mean, you would catch him in different moments where he would appreciate his horror days a lot more. And deep down, I know that he did appreciate it, but he really wanted to have that image of, you know, doing the A-list big movies for sure. Whereas Peter Cushing was kind of different. You know, he liked being a big fish in a small pond and really loved being, you know, the star of these horror films and felt very lucky and privileged to you know, to have found that niche for himself. They just were very, very different in that way. Well, then Christopher asked me to, you know, invited me to stay for the rest of the day to watch the shooting. And they did a few scenes, no shagging, no car crashes, unfortunately, but it was fun. They did a dining room scene with Roger Moore and Britt Eklund and Christopher Lee and Hervé Villechaize and everything. And at the end of the day, he said, do you want to share a ride back to London? And there's a Rolls Royce limousine from the studio. And I'm like, yeah, that'd be great. So I get in and Christopher Lee and Hervé Villechaize are sitting in the back seat. And I have to sit on this little fold down seat that's behind the chauffeur where I'm facing the two of them, where I'm facing Christopher and Hervé. And of course, I'm sure most of your listeners know who Hervé Villechaize is, but in case you don't, he's the little actor from Fantasy Island who's always doing "da plane, da plane." And anyway, Hervé is now 10 sheets to the wind, drunk as a skunk. And we start to drive back to London, and Hervé starts to regale us with stories about all the prostitutes he's hired since he's arrived in London. And he is using every foul, you know, word in the book and going into details. And I'll say this as nicely as I can. He kept repeating the word pussy, but with his, he had a very strong lisp, so it always came out pussy. And Christopher Lee started to giggle, and I started to giggle, and every time Herbie would say pussy one more time, we just kept we just lost it, and we were like doubled over laughing. And every time we'd compose ourselves, all Herve had to do, and he knew it, was to say that word one more time, and we completely fell out of our chairs.
That's and a great story.
It was so funny, and it was just so surreal, because Christopher Lee is usually rather demure and rather, you know,
stoic,
refined, and you just don't think of him as howling hysterically doubled over. And,
no,
and especially, you know, my image of him as Count Dracula. I mean, it just is so contradictory to all of that. And so it was very surreal. And when we dropped him off at his home, 45 Cadogan Square, I'll never forget it. we're pulling away from the curb, and I look out the back window of the Rolls Royce, and Christopher is literally just standing at the gate of his home, just doubled over laughing, trying to get it out of his system before he has to go in and face his wife. And because I'm sure he does not want to have to tell her why he's so hysterics and in hysterics, but it was crazy. It was wild. And just to show you how incredibly lucky I was. I mean, it's just the luck is just unbelievable. I get back to the hotel. Immediately, I want to go see Diana Rigg in the West End performing on stage in Pygmalion, where she's playing Liza Doolittle. And I want to interview her, of course. I'm going to go to the stage door and see if I can meet her after the show, because I want to interview her because she played Vincent Price's daughter in Theater of Blood. And she was Emma Peel in the Avengers TV series. And she was in the James Bond film Majesty's Secret Service. And I was a huge fan of hers. So I get to the theater. It was sold out for weeks, but I was hoping that somebody might be selling a ticket out front, or an extra ticket, or somebody who canceled or whatever. And lo and behold, yes, there's a guy there holding up a ticket. I go and buy it. I go in. It's like the seventh row center, incredible ticket. And I'm waiting for the show to start, and I hear this very familiar laugh behind me. I turn around, and it's Vincent Price.
Before I can
open my mouth to say anything, he goes, "Sam, what are you doing here?" Because he remembered me from when I had met him before. And by then I'd met him a couple times. I had gone to a lecture tour that he had been in and reacquainted myself with him there at the stage door. But he remembered me. And so I told him, I'm hoping to meet Diana Rigg. And he said, "Well, you're coming backstage with us after the show. And by the way, have you met my fiance, Coral Brown, who's sitting right next to him?" And she had played one of the critics in Theater of Blood who he had killed. And he had met her on Theater of Blood. In fact, Diana Rigg was the one who introduced them originally. And so they took me backstage, and I met Diana Rigg, and how could she say no when they're putting her on the spot? And she agreed to do the interview, and I came back on a day when she was doing a matinee and an evening performance. We did the interview between the shows, and she was fantastic, and just incredible stuff. So, yeah, I mean, it's that day between Christopher Lee and Hervé Villegas and Vincent Price and Diana Rigg and Coral Brown and Roger Moore. I mean, just like, could I have met more celebrities in one day? I don't think so.
That's just a dream come true.
Yeah, it was nuts. It was nuts.
And actually, Diana Rigg unfortunately passed away last year, but she's in probably my favorite movie so far this year. She's the landlord in Last Night in Soho, which
I have yet to see that movie. Oh my god, you have to see it. It's so good. And
I've heard good things about it.
Edgar Wright is he also directed Shaun of the Dead and Baby Driver. I just think he's kind of he excites me the way that Brian De Palma excited me back in the 70s when I was young, because he obviously is a huge fanboy. He loves these older films that he's always making references to. I mean, you may not have even noticed this, but of course it goes back in time in Last Night in Soho, and there's Thunderball on the in front of a movie theater and stuff. But as they're breezing by, there's a poster for Dr. Terror's House of Horrors, the Amicus Portmanteau movie. And I was like, yes! Oh, it's so cool. I just thought that was the coolest little Easter egg that he threw in there, that if you blink, you miss it. But I saw it, and I knew it was intentional. And I think it's a great movie. And we don't want to give anything away, but Diana Rigg is not a cameo. She's a major character in this movie. Yeah. And it was a great, great...
was Game
just
of Thrones.
A great send-off for her. I mean, oh my god, it gives me chills.
And actually, I love that Dr. Terror's House of Horrors poster. I actually have an original Spanish version of it with Peter Cushing with the tarot deck. It's framed, and it's in my storage locker in LA. I gotta get out there and dig it out eventually and hang it. But actually, right behind here is my roommate's poster of Scott Pilgrim versus the World. He's a big Edgar Wright fan too. So we went to see that like a week or two ago, and I was just mystified by how unbelievably beautiful that movie is. I loved every second of it. And yeah, Edgar Wright, clearly a monster kid. When you see his fake trailer in Grindhouse for Don't, it references all the Amicus and Hammer films and all you know, the it's, I absolutely love that. Loved everything he's done so far. So he, as far as I'm concerned, he hasn't had a miss yet.
No, I agree with you. I mean, he's just, I just love the guy. And I, you know, I just enjoy the enthusiasm that he has for the genre and for his fellow monster kids and all the Easter eggs that he's putting in there for us to find. And, you know, it's exciting. I love seeing his films. Even if he were to misfire, I know it's going to be an interesting movie anyway, you know what I mean? It's just and it's the same with De Palma. I mean, you know, De Palma's had misfires, but I always find them interesting in one way or another. I mean, there's just always, you know, fun stuff in there.
So was there ever any discussion with either Christopher Lee or Peter Cushing or Diana Rigg of you doing a film with them, or was anything ever in motion that just never materialized? I know you mentioned Vincent Price earlier.
Yes. You know, I would have loved to have worked with all of them. There was some discussion of adding Diana Rigg to the cast of the Vincent Price movie that I was doing to try to help raising money and stuff, but that never materialized. And but no, you know, it just, unfortunately, those, you know, in trying to raise money for these little movies, a lot of those names by the time I was directing were either, you know, they just didn't mean that much anymore. You know, my first film didn't get off the ground until 1990. And so, yeah, it's, and the fact that they were in England and I was making films back in those days, mostly in LA, it was too expensive to bring people in. You know, I would cast all kinds of cool names, but most of them were local. You know, we weren't flying them in. We were just basically saying, hey, can you get in your car and come over here for a day and do a cameo or whatever, and that sort of thing. So, you know, had they all lived in LA, I would have certainly been trying to do that much, much more than I was. We did try to get Christopher Lee to play the Vincent Price character in Elvira's Haunted Hills. I don't think he ever saw the script or even knew about the offer. His agent just said, no, he doesn't do those kinds of films anymore. And, you know, basically turned us down flat. And which was very disappointing, because I think he could have been,
such an asset.
Knowing his sense of humor that he's got in there, you know, I think he would have really had a fun time with it. And he knew Vincent well. They did a couple of films together, Oblong Box and what was the Oh, gosh. What was the portmanteau that had Vincent Price, Christopher Lee, Peter Cushing? Not Monster Club, but it was House of Long Shadows.
Okay. I was just fixing to look it up because I was going nuts.
But at any rate, they, you know, they knew each other and were big, you know, they loved each other. And they also share the same birthday, May 27th.
Okay. A day before Peter Cushing's birthday.
Yes. Peter Cushing is the day before. It's crazy. It's crazy that they were all born on those days. But at any rate, it would have been really fun. But that just didn't work out, unfortunately. I would have loved it.
Peter passed away in like 93, 94 also. Yeah. So yeah, that would have been.
Yeah, he was quite elderly by the time I was getting my directing into gear. And Vincent passed away right around then too. So, you know, there was no, you know, he was not around when he had already passed away by the time we did Elvira's Haunted Hills. Cassandra had actually tried to cast him in the first Elvira movie, Elvira, Mistress of the Dark, as Vinny character. I mean, it was really written for Vincent Price, but he ended up turning it down. Cassandra thinks that his wife, Coral Brown, was a little jealous of Vincent's attentions to Cassandra. And also just,
it's a beautiful woman. I mean,
yeah. But also felt that, that it was a little more risque. I don't think Vincent or Coral fully understood that it was going to be a PG, you know, movie. I think they thought that this very sexy woman with the cleavage and everything was going to, you know, that it was going to turn into, you know, more of an R-rated.
She's quite funny, though. I mean, I love her shows. I mean, we grew up on that because I was a teenager in the 80s. Yeah. So, I mean, we were there. Well, we used to have Monster Movie Matinee out of Syracuse. Me and Keith talk about that all the time because that's where we got our love of horrors. My mother would turn that on and we watched Bela Lugosi movies, and we would watch all of the, you know, they'd have Hammer films on. They would, you know, as it was. You know, back then, though, when they had them coming on regular matinee time, until I got a little older, I didn't know all the stuff that was cut out of those. There was a lot of stuff in there that's like, wow, this is not the version I first saw when I was 13.
Yeah.
They're just great films, and it must be awesome to have known those people. Like Vincent Price, a lot of people think he's just known for horror. I mean, one of my favorite movies he made was a black and white with Jennifer Jones and Song of Bernadette.
Yes.
He was so good in that. I mean, just excellent. I mean, he was a one of a kind person, I bet.
And he was a great comedic talent too.
No, he had quite a varied career, but you know, he certainly embraced the horror thing in the same way that Peter Cushing did. You know, he was happy to have this niche and to be, you know, the king of horror. You know, he was very happy about
that. That's what made it so good. They embraced their part in it. They might not have won the big Oscars and all that, but they loved what they were doing, and that just shines through in all the productions.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, you talk about me engaging with my fans. I mean, Vincent engaged with his, I mean, he always wrote, if you wrote letters to him, he would write back. Same with,
that is so
with Peter Cushing. I mean, they just, you know, were always incredibly generous with their time. And it was an inspiration to me for sure.
So you're known for working with probably one of the probably two biggest horror hosts around right now, because it's probably Elvira and Joe Bob Briggs are the two biggest ones, and then there's Sven Gulli and some others. Mm-hmm. And going back, when you were a kid, I guess they were more regional, like New York had Zachary, which unfortunately, you know, I only got to see very little of by the time I was born. South Carolina, I'm trying to think if there was anybody.
No, I grew up in Asheville, North Carolina, and went to college in South Carolina. But in Asheville, no, our shock theater was just a low budget, nothing affair. There was no host. They just had a title card that came up shock theater, and then they played the movie. So no, I did not have, I did not grow up with that, and I regret that. And Cassandra Peterson had the same problem. She did not have a horror host where she grew up, and in Manhattan, Kansas, and there was nothing there either. So, you know, we learned about horror hosts actually, you know, through Famous Monsters of Filmland. There'd be pictures of Zachary or Vampira or, you know, some of the other local ones. But yeah, it was a phenomenon that I didn't really know about, you know, hadn't experienced personally.
I guess the other quick thing is, I saw a story that you told on Facebook, because like you said, your father owned the theater, and there was a screening of Bloody Mama where they sent down this no-name actor who's in the movie.
Yes. So,
I don't want to spoil who that is, so go ahead.
Yeah, so it's 1970, and so I'm like 14. And American International released this movie called Bloody Mama. It was directed by Roger Corman, and it starred Shelley Winters as the head of this family of gangsters. You know, it's kind of, you know, Bonnie and Clyde sort of era, and they sent around. Basically, they were sending around an old car that was, used in the movie, you know, vintage car from like the 30s or, you know, when the film took place, and sending one of the actors who played one of Shelley Winters' sons in the movie, who was, you know, she had trained all of her sons to be bank robbers or whatever. And so this guy shows up at our theater with the car to do photo ops with the local newspaper and, you know, whatever. And so I, you know, I'm excited to meet somebody, and especially excited to meet someone who's been directed by Roger Corman, who did all the Vincent Price Edgar Allan Poe movies, which I'm so fanatical about. And my dad introduces me to him, and then we take him out to lunch at this fancy restaurant across the square, and they required coats and ties, and this person didn't have a coat and tie, and luckily the maitre d' had a loaner that they gave to him, and you know, we have lunch, and we're talking about Roger Corman and blah, blah, blah. And it was all really cool. And I just wanted to ride off into the sunset with this guy to go, you know, get into movies. And then, you know, literally this is 70. And in 1974, this guy wins the Oscar for Best Supporting Actor in Godfather 2. And his name is Robert De Niro. So, yes, I met Robert De Niro at 14 at my dad's theater. You know, it was just crazy. Just crazy. Ironically, he had really been discovered by Brian De Palma. He was in Greetings and Hi Mom, which are two of De Palma's earliest films.
And the
way. And was making those right around the same time that I met him. So it's just kind of weird that, you know, that there's this De Palma thing that was, you know, leading us all in the direction of, you know, bigger and better things.
That's fantastic. And yeah, here he is, this unknown actor who's sent to do this little gig in a movie theater. And yeah, 4 years later, now he's one of the most iconic actors to ever live.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And he was, you know, he just drove off to go to another theater in another town. You know, he was like doing the whole circuit around, you know, barnstorming in North and South Carolina, and went to a couple of my father's other theaters in other towns. I mean, it was just so crazy to think back on that now.
You don't get that kind of showmanship anymore either.
No, you really don't. No, it was showmanship thing was such a different thing back in those days.
The closest you get to that now is film festivals, or someone like Lloyd Kaufman will go to all the different cities that are showing his films. But generally, yeah, it doesn't really exist anymore. You get to meet filmmakers now if you go to like the local horror film festival that's premiering something, and you might meet somebody who 10 years from now is one of the biggest directors in Hollywood.
Yeah. You know?
But it's absolutely fantastic. So I guess unless Vicky has anything else she wants to ask, I guess The last question that I want to ask you is for any young filmmakers who might be listening to this or anyone who's aspiring to it, do you have any advice for them? Should they come out to LA? Should they do things from where they are? What would you tell someone who's just starting out?
Wow. It's really tricky. I mean, everybody nowadays has a tremendous advantage over what I had as a kid. When I was a kid, if you're going to be making a film, you'd had to make it on 8mm. It cost a lot. It cost your entire allowance and then some to have 3 minutes and 20 seconds of silent footage that you'd have to send off to be developed. And there was no erasing, yeah. no take twos. And, you know, it was really hard. Nowadays, everybody's a filmmaker. You've got it. Your cell phone, you can make entire movies. Steven Soderbergh has made entire feature films on his iPhone.
Got cinematic everything on this phone.
Yes.
I mean, my daughter's going, how did you do such a good video of Ashford's, my grandson's birthday, you know, happy birthday
song? Yeah.
I go, I put it on cinematic. I go, he had a cinematic happy birthday song.
Exactly.
Beautiful, though. I mean, holy cow.
Yeah. So, gosh, I mean, if you're an aspiring filmmaker, just get that iPhone and practice. Just make films as many as you possibly can all the time. Get your friends to act in them. You know, you can do everything with no budget. It's such a dream that I wish I had when I was young. And you know, post those online, try to raise your profile, social media and everything. You've got to use that to get your work seen. Mm-hmm. I don't think you have to come to LA. LA is very, very, very competitive. It's very expensive to live here. You're going to have to, you know, get a job waiting tables or whatever to be able to pay rent and that kind of stuff to keep yourself going. I think it's more important to use social media to raise your profile so that by the time, you know, so that when it feels like it makes sense to come to LA, then, you know, you already have some sort of profile. You've done some films that have gotten into festivals or, you know, whatever. You should use all of those resources. But the other thing that I always tell people is that whether it's actors or directors or whatever, if you're saying, well, I'm going to try to make it in the business, I'm going to give it a couple of years, and if I don't, then I guess I'll just go do another job. My advice is, if that's your attitude, don't bother. It has to be an obsession that's in your blood where you are thinking, I am going to be a film director. I don't care if I only make iPhone films for no budgets for the rest of my life, I'm going to be making films one after another from now until the day I die, even if I have to have another side job to pay the rent. That's the attitude that you need to have in order to make it in this crazy competitive business. Right. You've got to be obsessed and on fire about it, and nothing is going to stop you. So, you know, if that's the passion that you have, then just pursue it. Just do it. You can totally do it for yourself. I couldn't do it for myself back in those days. I mean, you know, it was, you really had to have a lot of money to make. When I made my short film Double Negative on 35mm, it cost me $25,000 that I put on credit cards and had to pay off for years. And in today's dollars, that would have been, you know, probably $50,000 or $75,000. Mm-hmm. You know, I could have done that on an iPhone for nothing. So you have the incredible advantage. I mean, there's a lot more competition because everybody else has that same advantage. So you do have a lot of other people who are doing the same thing, granted. But You've just got to pursue it. You've just got to take the resources that you have with an iPhone and use it to death. And, you know, it's the more practice you have, the better you're going to get at it. The more variety of things you're going to be able to have to show people what you can do. And every time you're making a film, the actors that you meet, the crew, they're going to have contacts and other people that they've worked with. And, you know, you're just going to be able to network and work your way up. And festivals are a great way to meet people. So you just got to do it. Just be in the game.
Yeah. And one of the major things about festivals, and I learned this way too late, is when you get there, don't worry about winning the award. Worry about going and meeting everybody else.
Yeah.
And
networking.
You hit the nail on the head that networking is a big thing. Most of my work, most any film work that I get now usually ends up coming from people that I met on other films. I made a film years ago with Linnea Quigley, Joe Estevez, Robert Zadar, Felissa Rose, and Joe Estevez. Every couple of months, someone will contact me because Joe talked me up to them. And even right now, I just started something now because of it. So networking is a huge, huge thing. I learned that way too late. I wish I would have learned that in my 20s because I was one of those kids. I was like, oh, well, I'm talented enough that people will notice me. No. People have to open doors for you
It's very true. You've got to network, and you can't let the rejection, you know, if you don't win the award, you don't get picked up for distribution or, you know, whatever, or if you're an actor, you don't get those, you go to a lot of auditions and don't get the part. You can't let that rejection get to you. I mean, that's just part of the game. That is part of the business. You've got to get a thick skin. You've got to look at every single one of those as an opportunity, you know, and use it to the best of your abilities for networking and meeting people and just, you know, taking little baby steps and being patient.
Is there any other question that Vicky has?
Well, I was going to ask him a lot of questions, but he answered all of my questions. So I didn't really have to do too much talking for the first time.
Yeah, you wind me up. I'm the Energizer Bunny. Sorry.
Oh my God, you're a fountain of information.
I made a similar joke when I was talking to Vicky right before we started the interview. Like, you just put it seems with you, we just put in the quarter and just enjoy the ride.
Yeah. I was saying, it's like usually, you know, they know what they're gonna say, and it's just great having, you know, I mean, your career spans decades. I know it's that possibly we'd have to have another whole 2 hours to get more of your life involved in it, but you've achieved so much, you know, and it's great how you treat your fans. I mean, that does not ever go unnoticed. People really that's appreciate sweet.
Well,
that.
I love my sandwiches.
I noticed that when you friended me on Facebook, it's like, oh God, he really likes his fans. And that's just really just great to see, because not everybody reaches out as much, you know.
Yeah, I don't understand that. I mean, you know, I do what I do for my sandwiches.
And you've had a hell of a career, man. It's been fantastic. And I mean, probably the pandemic slowed you down, but as far as I can tell, you're still a working director.
So yeah, I've got a couple of films that I'm contracted to do, but they keep getting postponed because of the pandemic, and hopefully they'll happen early next year.
Speaking of which, Sam's toilet paper caper. That's another thing that you did recently because you were trying to help raise money for the World Health Organization, and you did pretty well with that.
Yes, it's I've donated over $3,000 with the profits of this little parody of a kid's book. You know, the little golden book storybooks that we all read as kids. Well, I did parody of one called Sam's Toilet Paper Caper. And remember at the beginning of the pandemic how you couldn't get toilet paper anywhere?
Yes.
Well, I was like, I need to write a parody of this craziness of trying to find toilet paper. So,
oh my God, it's excellent.
I got this illustrator friend of mine, Dan Gallagher, who is hilarious. And we, you know, collaborated on this incredible little book. And we have all these movie references in the illustrations. We cast Peter Lorre as the supermarket attendant. And there's an homage to Carrie and Sound of Music and Good, Bad, and the Ugly. And there's a reference to Julie Newmar's Catwoman. I mean, it's got all kinds of fun stuff in it. It's only $10. You can get it on Amazon. And all the profits go to the World Health Organization COVID-19 Solidarity Response Fund. And I'm just really proud of it.
Wonderful. So anything you'd like to plug right now before we go?
Anything well, in the pipeline?
There's I did a massive interview with Elvira in the new issue of The Dark Side, number 222, which I see you have, Joe. And it's half of it is on the making of Elvira's Haunted Hills, where we tell all the funny stories of making that movie. But the other half of it, I tried to think of questions that as an Elvira fan, I've never heard her, you know, I've read so many interviews right. with her and I've never heard her asked. And one of the things was, as a fanboy, she talks about Vincent Price all the time. We both do. But I wanted to know, had she met other horror stars? And she had never really been asked this. And I asked her, I said, did you ever meet Christopher Lee? And she goes, oh my God, no one's ever asked me that. Yes, I did meet him. And so she talks about that. I'm not going to tell you what it is. And she talks about, you know, John Carradine and Barbara Steele and Martine Beswick and all this cool stuff that you can't find anywhere else. And it's not in her memoir either. So you got to check out this magazine.
Someone else I want to ask you about. I want to ask you about Martine Beswick because she's in one of my favorite Hammer films. She's in Dr. Jekyll and Sister Hyde.
Yes, Dr. Jackson's Sister Hyde. She was also the second female lead in 1 Million Years B.C. She has the wrestling match with Raquel Welch. And she was in two Bond movies, Thunderball and From Russia with Love. You know, it's one of the few actresses to be in two Bond films.
No one ever remembers anybody from 1 Million Years B.C. besides
Raquel Welch. Okay.
It's a guy flick, huh?
But Martine, when I was doing Magic Island for Charlie Band, there's a three-headed tiki god that was done with this sort of puppetry. And I wanted three distinctive voices for the three heads. So I got Isaac Hayes, Terry Sweeney, who was the guy who introduced me to Cassandra Peterson, who used to be on Saturday Night Live, and he has a really funny voice. And Martine Beswick, who has a really distinctive, very British, very dry, very sexy voice. And so the three of them, I gathered them. At that time, Martine lived in L.A., which was very lucky because that's how I was able to work with her.
She was working for you and Fred Olin Ray and a lot of, go ahead.
So I gathered them into a recording studio, and that's how I met Martine. And then we reconnected at Monster Bash in Mars, Pennsylvania, a couple years ago. Well, just before the pandemic, in 2019, I guess, in June, and reconnected. And we were just cackling. I mean, you know, she's so, so great. I just absolutely love her to death. Such a great woman, and so funny and sardonic, and she's a dream.
Well, yeah, I kept saying that was going to be the last question that I ended up asking. I don't want to waste your entire day because I'm sure I could just get you to talk about like old monster movies. Probably
we could have another 2 or 3 hours to pick your brains on that one.
Because... And I'm sure you want to get on with your day, so I'm gonna. I think this is a great time to let you go. Thank you so much.
So appreciate
my pleasure. Loved it, guys.
Yeah, thanks for how you treat your fans. Thank you for shit. Yeah, you produced and directed a lot of movies that I grew up with. So thank you for that as well.
So many, too many to name. They're all awesome.
And also, anybody listening, do buy the Blu-ray to Elvira's Haunted Hills because it looks fantastic. I watched it when I first got it, then I rewatched it the other night with the commentary track on, which you guys are hilarious on it. And where can they find you on social media? I think you're everywhere, right?
I'm mainly on, my favorite is Facebook because I write long posts and they don't let you write unlimited amounts on certainly not on Twitter and very limited also on Instagram, but I am on all three, but definitely check me out on Facebook. You're going to get the unedited version there.
Okay.
Well, thank you again very much. Awesome. Have a great day.
Have a great holiday season, too.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
Happy Thanksgiving.
Absolutely. Happy holidays to you guys. Thanks for having me.
On your single bed. I want to hear all about it. Get the toll off your chest. Ooh, I feel the tears and you're not alone. Oh,
When I hold you, well, I won't let go. Why should we care for what they're selling us anyway? We're so young, girl, and you know. You don't have to be there, babe. You don't have to be scared, babe. You don't need the plan of what you wanna do. Won't you listen to the man that's loving you? Your world keeps spinning and you can't jump off, but I will catch you if you fall. I can't tell you enough. I hate to hear that you're feeling low. I hate to hear that you won't come home. Oh, why should we care for what they're selling us anyway? We're so young, girl, and you know. You don't have to be there, babe. You don't have to be scared, babe. You don't need a plan of what you wanna do. Won't you listen to the man that's loving you? Easy breezy if you come with me, ooh. Easy, easy, and a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 9, 9, 9. You don't have to be there, babe. You don't have to be scared, babe. You don't need a plan of what you wanna do. Won't you listen to the man that's loving you? You don't have to be there, babe. You don't have to be scared, baby. Don't need a plan of what you wanna do. Won't you listen to the man that's loving you? Oh, oh.